Hi guys, it's Dakota. Happy Monday, actually. It's Tuesday, October 1st, and I had started posting this, or I started recording yesterday on Monday so that I could get it posted on Monday because that is the day that I post videos. And it was just one of those days. I had interruptions. It was just sort of one of those crazy days, and I just really started to get frustrated. And so I thought, well, I was going to try to rush through it. And then I thought, wait, you know what? Tomorrow is October 1st. And so even though it's Tuesday, it's October 1st, and I really felt like posting it today. So happy Tuesday and happy October 1st. I hope that everyone had a great week last week for whether you celebrate the harvest festival, the autumn equinox, the spring equinox, I wish, fall equinox, Mabon, Maybone, Maybon, however you like to pronounce it. I call it Harvest Home. I also call it Mabon. If you haven't watched my video, I posted that last week on Mabon, and Mabon, I think it's called Mabon, Harvest Home, and Autumn Equinox. You might want to go ahead and check that out if you're new, or if you just want to hear what I have to say. A little bit of history tidbit information in there that I found really interesting, and a little bit about how I deal with Mabon, what it means to me, etc. So go ahead and check that out if you want. My husband was on vacation for, I'm going to lead up to how today's subject came up. So my husband was on vacation for 7 days, I think it was 6 or 7 days, and he just got home last Wednesday. And while he was, and I do a lot of reading anyway. I read, I read blogs, etc. And but not quite as much as I did the week that he was gone, because I was bored at night. I had more free time to myself, more private time and alone time, no interruptions, etc. And so I actually just read, I did a lot of catching up. I caught up on some blogs that I had tagged that I wanted to read. And so how when you start something, and especially me, y'all have been watching my videos, and or if you know me personally, I'm sort of that squirrel person where I'm talking about this, and then, oh, look, and I'm off in another direction. I was doing the same thing with the blogs. So what was happening is I would read something, and then, either something, I found something really interesting in the blog, and that would make me research or check out a link that they had posted, etc. So it was really sort of all over the map in reading. And that led me to some blogs and some websites that were created and made by those who were sort of just starting out, was my feeling. It was my feeling that they were just sort of starting out in witchcraft, or on the path, whatever you want to call it. Can kind of tell by the subject matter and stuff like that, and what they had to say. And there was this common thread that I found throughout, and then that made me do a little more research, and I realized that that is something that is talked about and is taught in a lot of our modern witchcraft 101 books that are out. And so, but some of these blogs, I don't know, it just sort of triggered something in me. And so that brought me to this subject of having a magical name or having a craft name. And so today I'm just going to talk about my thoughts on it. All right, so a magical name. So a little bit of history about it. Back in the day, back in the ancients, the Middle Ages, or the during the witch trials and the burning times, etc. changing your name, having another name, it probably at that point was not called a craft name or called a magic name or whatever. Maybe it was, but changing your name probably was a wise decision because it was a matter of life or death. I mean, you couldn't be, and I don't want to use names because I've read a lot of comments on YouTube videos and even and blogs and stuff where the person that was doing the blog or doing the video just pulled a name out of a hat to use so that they could have a name. And then there's a person that has that name and they're offended or whatever. So I'm not going to use that. I'm going to use the letter of the alphabet and I'm just going to use A. So let's just say that your given name is A. Well, back in the day, like I said, it would have been wise to refer to yourself as B because if they found out that A is the one that was the witch that was involved with midwifery or herbal medicine and things that were considered witchcrafty, then of course, then they were going to be accused and most likely prosecuted as a witch. So I think that is where the tradition started. And so in today's world, we still have a lot of prosecution going on. And so there are those of us who practice, not me personally, but those of us who practice that have reasons why, personal reasons why we choose a craft name. Perhaps it's because we can't let our families know that we practice witchcraft. Maybe we don't want our coworkers or our jobs to know because it could be grounds for termination, even though I would like to think that they couldn't, that's probably the reason why you would get fired, but they're not going to say that's the reason. They would find another reason for you, to fire you. But so you have family and we've got friends and we have jobs and, we have all sorts of reasons why we would choose to have a craft name so that we can have some privacy, so that everybody doesn't know that we're witches or what it is that we're doing behind closed doors. And so again, so today in modern witchcraft, in the beginner books, I've seen where they go through different processes of having you find your magical name or your craft name, and it's been embraced. It's been embraced by the pagan as an umbrella term for all paths that might fall under that. It's a common practice for witches and practitioners of magic or practitioners of the occult to have a craft name, mainly for privacy. Now, there are other reasons why one would choose a craft name. There are, let's say that you are going to, there are some traditions and some covens that part of the requirement for your initiation would be to have a craft name, to choose a craft name. Some will allow you to choose your own craft name, and that can be done by a number of ways. It could be through meditation, it could be through dreams, numerology, divination. Maybe you just, had a vision. Maybe you were taking a walk out in nature and you found this really cool looking flower or some kind of neat mushroom or something, and you felt really connected to it, and so you took on that name. It really meant something to you. The energies of it resonated with you or whatever. And so you would, then maybe you wanted to take on that name. There are some traditions, covens, etc., that groups that actually will give you a name after a period of time. So you might, they might take you into their group and start working with you, and you might start studying with the group, etc. And after a time period, they, once they get to know you and feel your energies and whatever, then they might come up with a name for you. And then that would be your craft name. Now, in certain covens, if especially if they are an oath-bound or a private or a secret group, then part of that process would be, okay, you're initiated as, we give you the name as, or you have taken the name as A, as your craft name, and that name is only to be used in circle, in ritual, in our group. It isn't a name that we share out in the public. So if I see you at the mall, I'm not going to yell across the mall, hey, hey, how you doing? Because that would be going against our promises and our oath that we took when we joined the coven or the group or the tradition or whatever it is. If it was a you know, a private thing that you did. Some people like to have two craft names. One would be their craft name that is only for private reasons, and maybe it's private just between you and deity that you work with, or you and your spirit guides that you work with. So, but the point being that one, you know, that would be a private name that isn't shared amongst anyone except your group, your coven, or your guides, your deity, or whatever. Some like to have an additional craft name that they will use out in public, that they're okay, their families know that they're different, let's say, and you choose a craft name that you want to be called out publicly, that you've just sort of embraced that name, and you know, maybe your family doesn't agree with it, and maybe they still call you by your given name, but you've given permission to people that you've met to call you by your, would be your second craft name, so we'll call that B. So now when I see you out in public, I can say, hey, B, and you're okay with it because you have given permission to be called by that name. So there's two things. One is private, whether it's tradition or initiatory with a coven, whether you name yourself, take on a name through whatever resources that it comes to you. Maybe you just like it, you know, whatever. And that would be your private name. And then, like I said, others choose craft names because same thing. Maybe it resonates with them. It fits with them. They divined it. It came in. They did numerology. This is the name. They found that cool flower and it resonated with them, and they've just always liked the name. It's fun. And so that becomes their magical crafty name that they use publicly. And so that's fine too. Now, one of the things about the craft name is, as I mentioned in previous video on altars, and I think there's two videos on that. So if you haven't watched those, you might want to. There's some information in there. Skip over the parts you don't want to listen to. But I'm going to stop right here real quick and squirrel a little bit and just let you know that there's some parts in my videos in which I talk about OCD. And I call it my OCDism. And although I am, you know, I still have some issues. I'm not crazy with OCD anymore about some things, about most things. There's a few things that I'm still a little like phobic and OCD about. So you might want to listen to those videos because I talk a little bit about it. And I think I mentioned in the last video that I've actually had a couple of private messages from a couple of people who we're now sort of getting to know each other And they just private messaged me. They're not ready to come out with that. They're actually feeling with, some embarrassment and some shame, and families and friends don't understand it. And so to have somebody that's out with it, I guess, and on this path, and they're on this path. So I'm meeting people through that connection as well. And so I might be using OCD in some of my YouTube videos. So anyway, that being said, in the altar videos, I talk about OCD and how I like my altars very simple. One of the reasons is because when there is a lot of stuff on my altar, where I've been to public rituals and they're stunning. The altars are absolutely stunning. They're beautiful. I mean, just beautiful, beautiful, just beautiful. I get caught up in the checking out of everything and the placement of everything, and my mind is just swirling with the activity and the energy from everything that is on that altar. And so if the ritual is being hosted by someone else, I'm so busy in my head, the altar is so busy, and I am so busy in my head that sadly I miss half of what the host or the hostess is even talking about, and I hate that. I mean, that's just not it. So for me, having that simple altar allows me to have more focus on what I'm doing because I'm not being sidetracked by all the other things. Now, the same thing goes for having that craft name. Having that craft name can give you power. It can give you a sense of focus so that in my mundane life, I am, let's say, A. In my name in my mundane life is A. My craft name is B. So in my mundane world, my mundane life, people don't know that I practice witchcraft or magic or do any of that. And so my craft name B, when I sit down to do my crafting, then I am B. I hope that makes sense. So I'm still A, I'm still Dakota, but I take on the energies or the characteristics of my craft name because it was either given to me from spirit, higher source, I divined it, it was given to me by by a group. However I got my craft name, there is power within that name. And so when I sit down to do my ritual or to do my crafting, I have a better, I have more focus. That being said, everybody knows that I am out. So you can go, hey, there's Dakota, she's a witch, and I'll be like, yeah, and your point, define witch if it was said in a negative way. But I'm looking at my notes real quick, make sure I covered everything that I wanted to talk about. So that being said, this is the thing that I found disturbing in the videos, in some of the videos. And then as I looked back at some of the books, I didn't find one book. Well, I didn't read all the books, but I read a couple of the beginner books. I went back and read a couple of the beginner books. One of the things that I found really disturbing was when it came to discussion of your craft name, it has, okay, we're going to start here with witchcraft or teaching you beginner witchcraft. So part of it was you should have a craft name. I don't like the idea that you should have. There's no rule. It is not mandatory that you have a craft name. There's no law that says you have to have a craft name if you are going to be a witch, if you are going to practice witchcraft. There just is not a rule. It is not mandatory that you have one. So if you feel like you don't want one, or if one has not come to you as of yet and you want one, maybe you want a name but it just hasn't come to you yet, don't panic. It's okay. You don't have to have one. Practice your craft. Start practicing. Go ahead and continue your reading and continue to get your knowledge and check your resources and practice what it is that you're learning, because the craft name is not, it is not who you are, really. It is not where the power really comes from. The power really still comes from you. It still really comes from you. It may be able to help you focus, and it may put you in a different mindset, and all of that is awesome, and all of that can be extremely important in our magic. But what I'm saying is that it is not mandatory that you do. So when you read that or you hear that, well, you have to have a craft name. No, you don't have to have a craft name. If you are comfortable doing your magic with your given name, then that is powerful enough, and that is your magical name. So that's kind of what I wanted to talk about. I just, like I said, I did so much reading and studying over the week that he was gone, and for whatever reason, that never hit me before like it hit me this time. And I will say this, in the Witchcraft 101 class that I teach, I do teach finding our magical names, because it's something that if you are a new witch, if you're new to this path, you're going to read about that and you're going to hear about that. And it can be an important, I don't know, I'm just going to use this phrase. It can be an important rite of passage, which, you know, I've heard that used. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. I'm not one to judge and to debate that issue. But it is a step. It is a step that you can take as part of your magical practice. And so because of that, I teach that in my class. But I also teach, it is not mandatory that you have the magical name. You do not have to. If you don't want it, don't have it. If you can't come up with something and you really want to, you want something, then just be patient and it will come to you. Do some meditations, try to do some divination, take some nature walks, you know, try to talk to your guides if you have them, and see what happens with that. But don't get discouraged just because you don't have a craft name. That isn't the gods. And then I read this: you have to have a craft name or the gods won't recognize you. Really, I'm very sorry, but I think the gods know who I am. Therefore I serve them. They know who I am. And, yes, I said serve them, one in particular. And, you know, and that can be a whole other subject. What do I mean by serving? I serve no one. Okay. Well, okay. Anyway, so that's what I wanted to talk about today. And, you know, I hope that it just gave you some food for thought, if nothing else. It'll come to you at the right time. And if it doesn't come to you, that's because it isn't meant to be. And just understand that whether you have it or whether you don't have it, that the magic is within you, that you are the powerful one. You are the one. It is our words. It is our intentions that gives us the power and our knowledge. Don't forget the roots. It is the foundation of our path and our craft that gives us the power. Okay, so that being said, I'm going to go ahead and sign off now. Happy October 1st. I am looking forward to Samhain. We have a great ritual coming up and with my group and our class. And I'm already starting to make preps. And yeah, it's October. It's still hot. And here in Eastern North Carolina, I saw a little meme come up and it said it's Hot-tober. So I thought that was cute. All right, everybody, I'm going to see you next week, next Monday, hopefully, if everything goes smoothly. And again, thanks for watching. Please share, please subscribe. It means a lot. Make a comment so that I know you're here. And I look forward to seeing you next week. Thanks for tuning in. Bye, everyone.